So today's session, we are going to be joined by Amanda Reynolds, who's a Managing Director and Founder of Blend Associates. And she's going to be joined by Blend Coaches, Chris Burbeck and Edwina Love Lawrence. And they're going to be discussing coaching through a pandemic and wellbeing lessons. So over to you.
Thank you, Michaela. We're delighted to be here. If you could maybe put up the first slide, that would be great. Thank you. So we're delighted to be here today, and you may have joined us. This is your first session, or you may have been here all morning. So I hope that you won't be too exhausted if you have been in the sessions all morning. If you can move to the slide that has our mugshots, three mugshots on it, that would be fabulous. Thank you. So yes, I'm Amanda. Next one, please. Two mugshots there. There's one with three. Hi, I'm Amanda, and I'd like to welcome Chris Burbeck. Chris, take your sound off and say hi.
Morning, nice to meet everybody.
And Edwina Love Lawrence, who's also a member of our faculty. Edwina's there, I hope, to say hi to. Oh, she was there. I hope she's there. Can say hi to you. So we're going to talk to you, if I could pass on to the next slide, we're going to talk to you about our work coaching NHS leaders through the pandemic, and we're going to share some of the feedback we got from their self-reported anonymised survey. We're going to take you right back in time to March 2020, which is unbelievable that we're still working through the implications of a pandemic. Almost 2 years on. We're going to explore with you what we think wellbeing is and isn't, and we'll share some thoughts on wellbeing in the space of coaching and in the space of coach supervision. So I'm really delighted that we've got both Chris and Edwina here, because Chris and I came together initially to create the faculty back in March 2020, and Chris led the recruitment of coaches to the faculty. And as a supervisor and a coach himself, drew together an amazing group of coach supervisors, because to be an effective coach, you need to not just be qualified and in continuous professional development, but you need to be actively engaged with a trained coach supervisor. So I hope we'll be able to share with you the client experience and also the coach's experience here. We think there's some real lessons, and we don't want to get your thinking about your own and your team's well-being. Obviously, share as much or as little as you'd like. Jack's here from our team. Give everyone a wave, Jack. Jack's here, and he's going to monitor the chat while we speak. And at key points, we will stop after each section and give look at any reflections or any questions you've got. So please do feel able to contribute. So anything else at this point that you were hoping to get out of this session that's not covered here? Do unmute your mic, wave your hand, or use the little hand icon on the on your Zoom, and let us know if there's anything else you want us to cover. Nope. Silence, Jack, nothing in the chat. Okay, let's go ahead then. Let's talk about March 2020. So next slide, please. So back in March 2020, the Secretary of State for Health announced that the NHS was being put on an emergency footing. And Chris and I came up with the idea of how coaches could help in that space. So rather than us running away and hiding, running towards NHS leaders and the systems of leadership, because we thought that the word coach actually means to carry the village. And we saw the NHS and wider social care as a village of leaders who were going to be on a really difficult journey. So that was where this started, really. As they ran towards the pandemic, we would run towards them. And we thought there was a sweet spot in there, right in the middle of that, if coaches, the most experienced coaches and supervisors, were alongside NHS and social care leaders and their teams on this journey. Next slide, please. And then I'll... So, this is what it felt like. If you're a Trekkie fan, you know, give her all she's got, Captain. You know, there was a real sense of the NHS and social care just going on warp speed and running towards this challenge and reorganising the NHS and reorganising teams and focusing away from what had been the day-to-day work to the pandemic response. So I thought that might be quite a good analogy. So as the Starship Enterprise went on warp speed, Blend tried to think about our response as well, which is the next slide, and then I'm going to hand over to Chris. So we identified a clear customer need here, NHS leaders and their teams who we were already working with as coaches were saying, gosh, I don't know how I'm going to be able to do this. I don't know whether I've got the skills. And we had a pool of coaches who were suddenly available because all their work was cancelled. Coaches had tended to go into organisations on face-to-face assignments and the work got cancelled. So we thought, wow, we've got all these brilliant coaches that we know. Could we pull them together to meet this customer need? And obviously the building blocks were it needed to be tech-based, it needed to be through Zoom and MS Teams. Blend already had that way of working because I'd done some work in New York with a charity and a British school over there. We also had in place the associate model, although pre-pandemic, I worked with two or three other coaches. We're now working with 35. So, you know, scale up, but we had the sort of contracting and the model in place. And we were watching New York and Milan and thinking, gosh, this is coming our way. And I remember Chris and I had some discussions along those lines, established networks. And the NHS was already using executive coaches. So it was a language that a lot of colleagues already understood. So we sought to be agile, simple in our approach, fast, resilient. I just want to touch on price sensitive and courageous, because at the time, it felt like the right thing to do to be really aware of value for money and not taking advantage of the NHS when the rules of engagement were looser because of the procurement need to get services quickly. We wanted to make sure we were cost effective. That seemed like the obvious thing to do. With hindsight, gosh, lots of organisations didn't think that, and the prices of contracts that were charged and paid for both services that were delivered and services that weren't delivered is eye-watering. So at the time it felt like, well, that's just what we're going to do. We're going to be price sensitive. We're not going to take advantage of the NHS. Hindsight, gosh, that was absolutely the right thing to do, and not everyone was doing it. Courageous with a question mark. Edwina might touch on that a bit more from a supervisor perspective. You know, it has required a lot of our coaches to do this work. So again, with hindsight, we felt it was the right thing to do. We picked the most experienced coaches, and Chris will tell you more about that. Maybe running towards it rather than running away and hiding. And at that point, I'm going to hand over to Chris to talk a little bit about the faculty, and then we'll open for any questions or reflections. Next slide.
Thanks, Amanda. So Amanda's already touched on this, but one of the things that we kind of recognised was that there were coaches available, as Amanda said, because contracts were being cancelled because the NHS was in the state it was in. And we also recognised that actually the coaching space that the coaches would be operating in was going to be pretty complex, with a lot of potential emotional stuff coming into that space as people were facing up to the reality of what the COVID pandemic actually meant for them as leaders and health and social care staff. So the reason we pulled together these particular individuals was because they were all people that we had worked with, and we knew that they were really, really experienced. They were able to handle a range of different coaching spaces and coaches as well. And so what we asked them to do was join what we called the blend faculty of coaches and supervisors, so that they could work in a really flexible way and have opportunities to be deployed depending on the contracts that we were working on at the time. And as I said, the contract that we secured very quickly was with Norfolk and Waveney. And they had felt the same sort of theme that Amanda and I had been discussing in our conversations around the need to, you know, walk alongside the leaders rather than back away. What we'd noticed is a lot of other coaching organisations that had been engaged with the NHS weren't doing that, and particularly the NHS Leadership Academy, where a lot of the senior leaders get their coaching from. They had obviously just kind of closed down and their staff had been redeployed into various other pandemic tasks. So there was a real gap there. And as we were saying, you know, it was great that Norfolk and Waveney kind of felt that and asked us to go and step into this space with them. And that's what we did. That's what our fantastic coaches worked with in the first instance, a huge range of different leaders, middle leaders across Norfolk and Waveney, which was an STP at the time. And well, we'll move on a little while to talk about what we noticed, what we were noticing, but also what the impact of the coaching was as part of that. So yes, should we pause there or should we go into the wellbeing bit, Amanda? What's your sense?
Chris, why don't you pick up the next two wellbeing slides and then we can pause there.
Thank you. So, you know, the kind of focus of this conversation and the focus of all the conversations that Amanda and I have been having back in March 2020 was this bit about how, you know, how do we support the NHS and social care staff using, you know, various models, but particularly recognising that what the leaders and the other staff were really facing was this sense of trauma. And as I said, Edwina will pick up on some of that. And, you know, how could coaching really work to support individuals' well-being? So this slide just kind of talks to what well-being is defined as, I suppose, which is this kind of, you know, physical, mental and social well-being, and not just the absence of disease or infirmity. So we were really trying to focus on all of our coaches as whole beings. The whole kind of holistic approach was very important for us. I think that's, again, why we picked the coaches that we work with, because they were able to not just act in a transactional way, looking at issues and helping the coachee to solve them. That was important, but also it was the kind of wholeness of what was coming into the coaching space and how our experienced coaches could work with a range of different feelings, emotions, situations to really support staff as they moved into the pandemic and through the pandemic, which we'll show you in a couple of slides. Next slide, please.
So, what is wellbeing at work, Chris?
Yeah.
particularly during a pandemic.
You know, we were really conscious that even in those very early days of the pandemic, you know, this was sort of March, April, when, as Amanda said, you know, the NHS and social care were just kind of going into the pandemic and not really understanding what was going to happen and what it meant. And, you know, hindsight's a fabulous thing, isn't it? But we were already hearing from our coaches and people that we know within the NHS and social care system how well-being was being impacted upon, even in those early days. And these were some of the things that we were aware of. And we were talking to our coaches about in relation to how they would be working with our coaches and the leaders. And it's a bit about well-being being really integral to how you are at work and how you feel and how motivated you are. You know, we've all had really rubbish days when we've gone into work and not felt that sense of well-being, and we know what that feels like in terms of the impact. So that was a very conscious point we wanted to make. And it's a bit about, you know, how it impacts on your work relationships as well, how productive you feel, And this bit about psychological safety was really important. I suppose we'd kind of known about that, and we talked about that in the coaching space quite a lot, but it really began to get a real sense of urgency as the pandemic set in, that people were feeling psychologically unsafe for all sorts of reasons. And it wasn't just because the pandemic was kind of looming. It was the implications on themselves, on their families, on their work colleagues, on everybody, that was really undermining this sense of well-being. As I mentioned, kind of home and what was going on for families. You know, some of these people we were talking to had carer responsibilities, and they were really quite, you know, frantic with worry about how they would be operating and the implications of the people that they were looking after in, you know, at home or in other spaces.
And I suppose we'd add into that, Chris, that sort of long-term health condition. We encountered a lot of NHS leaders and HR directors who developed long COVID, you know, so have now got a long-term health condition as a result of this. People who felt they weren't properly trained to do what they needed to do, and a lot of anxiety and stress around that. And people who didn't necessarily feel well supported. You know, we have phases where people felt they didn't have the right PPE. New announcements were being made almost overnight, and very senior NHS leaders heard about it on the news when we all heard about it. So some really, really quite difficult stuff around. And you might have kids at home trying to do their year five maths homework, or an elderly relative who's sheltering that is going downhill because of isolation or fears around that. So all of this was going on. Yeah. So it might be a good place to stop there and see if people have got any questions about blending this space or anything that you're noticing here. Anyone in the chat want to say anything? No? We'll go on and share the data then, Chris. So why don't we share? So we did a self-evaluation. Everyone had 3 hours of individual coaching or 3 hours of team coaching. Everyone was band 8A and above, or they were a band 8A running a team. So we did some team coaching with sort of ward leaders where their boss was an 8A, but they were sevens. So Michaela, if you can show us the next slide, we've picked out some of the self-reported data here. And we're still working with NHS organisations. So we had data from that first contract up to October 2020. So sort of wave one, coming out, eat out to help out, numbers going up again, but you know, in that first wave. And then March 2021, where we picked up the waves leading into Christmas, the, you know, Boris stole Christmas scenario, and into a really difficult time in spring 21, including a lot of NHS trusts getting hit hard for the first time, and a lot of social care getting hit hard for the first time in that spring wave. So yes, we asked people to self-report anonymously, didn't we? And Chris, we've talked about this a lot, but you know, your observations about the numbers when we first pulled this data.
I suppose they were surprising, but not unsurprising, because we kind of knew it was there, but I think we were surprised how high some of these percentages were coming out, particularly around the sadness. And as you can see, there's two lots of data there, one up to October 20 and then data up to March 21. And it hasn't really changed. You know, we were hoping / expecting that some of this would start to get better. But as Amanda said, because every time it felt like we might be getting into a bit of a space where things could get better, it kind of got worse again. So it is interesting that these bar charts, you know, look very similar. and it'd be interesting to see how this, we did this again in sort of March 22. What would we be seeing here? Would this look different? I think is another really good question.
I think we'd hoped that the worst of it would have settled. Edwina can touch on that sort of windows of tolerance, how your brain works when you're in feeling anxiety and sadness. But yeah, that's the first slide. Next slide, Michaela, because I'm aware of time. We like this one, didn't we, Chris?
Yeah, we do like this one. What we did after we'd done that initial survey was go back to the people who had had coaching with our blend coaches, and you know, just ask the question: did coaching help you? And actually, what we saw was 60%. There was an absolute yes, which was brilliant, because if we can support, if through our coaching we were able to support 60% of those people, that was quite an achievement with everything else that was going on. And in terms of some of the things that the coachees said about their coaching experience, as you can see in the comments, that there was real opportunities for just greater cohesion, sharing of strategic direction, because that was one of the things that was I suppose people were feeling quite lost with, because it was so focused on the pandemic that they were losing contact with the organization. They were being moved around a lot, so this was really useful for the leaders and the others going through the coaching to get a better sense of how they fitted into the kind of grand scheme of things at the time.
And Chris, the next slide, if Michaela gives us the next slide, drills down really into some of the specific things. So this was a multi-choice, but people could say yes or no to these questions. And there's some really interesting data about the sort of, once you're in coaching, how it contributes to your building of resilience and a sense of well-being.
And I think key to this, and I was a nurse, as was Amanda a long time ago, is that we were kind of noticing, particularly around things like, I'm thinking more clearly, I have a plan, I communicate, I'm in more control of what's going on. We were seeing some sort of implications there in terms of patient safety and client safety as well, because as a response to that, or an impact to that, was people were able, particularly clinicians and professionals, were more able to step into spaces and prevent harm from happening, rather than feeling less able to do that.
And I think one last slide from us here, Chris, as a bit of a way into Edwina, then talking about the experience of coaches. So thinking about your coach, what do they bring to the process? So, once you're in coaching, some really high numbers here about listening, somebody who listens to you and what's going on for you, reflecting, thinking about what helps you and what limits you, considering more alternatives. The coach took a non-judgmental approach. It helped that our coaches were outside the organization. People could confidentially share what they were struggling with without feeling like, oh, they're going to think I'm not on this, I'm not up to this. And developing your thinking about how you practice and how you lead. Many people were put into new roles overnight. And so actually thinking this through. I wonder, given time, if we just pause there to see if there's any questions, and then we'll jump straight to Edwina's slide. So any questions or reflections from anyone there? We've got a silent audience. Jack, anyone in the chat? No, do feel free to comment. Quick question. Look at this. Brilliant. We got a question. That's a really good question. So the question we've got here, and I'm going to draw Edwina into this one here to answer. Quick question about the data you've shown. Some coaches didn't think coaching was beneficial to them, or they were unsure. So the other 40% of that question. Do you think for these, coaching may not have been the right intervention or support, rather than therapy or counselling? Great question, Edwina, about, we're coaches, not therapists.
Very, very much so. I mean, what you can't always determine what people's needs are right at the beginning of a coaching relationship. And also, with only three sessions, you could also just be touching the surface. It could also be that coaches with a coaching mindset rather than a therapeutic mindset, or I'm just here to listen and nothing else mindset, might actually not have been hitting the spot. It's really difficult to tease out exactly why coaching doesn't work for some people. Some people, it's just not their thing, and that's that. There can also be things going on in people's heads too, about not needing help. And if you say, oh, I'm getting some help and support around this, it means that you're weak and you're letting the side down. So there's a whole piece of research that can be done in that as to why people might not have found coaching to be the right intervention. It's very good that a lot of people did.
Yeah, and I think what we know 2 years on is that some people have come to coaching, and we work with HR directors and the support there. And sometimes we say this isn't appropriate for coaching. We were asked to do some work recently around supporting HR managers, that they asked for it as a coaching intervention around compelling people to have their vaccine. And we said, thank you for thinking of us, but no thanks. We think that what these staff are showing, there was a long list of trauma that really you need more of a therapy supervision intervention, and there's potentially an ethics challenge here as well. So we will, if we get approached for work now, we can spot where it's not right for us. Oh, that's interesting. There's lots of stigma around counselling, but is it less for coaching? I'm just going to give my personal experience, where I've coached a number of senior psychologists and a number of doctors. They've come willingly into coaching in a way I think they may not have come into therapy or counselling as an access point. And then through that, and through particularly doctors, the BMA have done a wonderful job the last 2 years around saying, this is difficult, this is trauma work, get help. You know, it's not a failing to get help. I've then gone down that sort of, oh, I'm going to get some counselling or I'm going to get some therapy route. Edwina, any other thoughts about them?
Again, it really does come back to people not feeling it's okay to ask for help, you know, at the root. And I think it's sort of a cultural thing that if you're not coping, in inverted commas, you really feel you're letting the side down. And especially in a leadership role, I'm not able to cope, I'm not keeping this in under control. And that's when you actually really do need to be getting support. But there's that sort of deep discomfort about not feeling that it's appropriate. Yeah, it's a very tricky situation to be in.
Absolutely. Shall we jump to Edwina's slides? We're happy, Michaela, for you to put a PDF version of the whole slide pack in the chat for people so that they can see those. But actually, let's jump through to coaching and self-compassion and hand over to Edwina from there. And then the supervisor's perspective. So if we, Kayla can jump us to what I've got as slide 17. Slide 18. Back again. Slide 18. Thank you. Edwina, over to you. You know,
just briefly say a little bit about me. I'm a coach and I'm a coach supervisor. And one of the key principles behind my work is who you are is how you coach and how you supervise. So this is very much a personal perspective. And also to say that I'm staying true to one of the blend values here, which is being the difference. So supporting coaches through the pandemic has made me look very deeply about how I support myself, not just to do this piece of work to the best of my ability, but also to keep grounded. I mean, really grounded in the face of the huge existential crisis that we were all caught up in. Right at the very beginning of this whole piece, I went on a piece of CPD about existential courage, which had to stick with me all the way through. It was that sort of, oh my goodness, this is scary for all of us. So as with many people who weren't directly on the front line when the pandemic struck, my first reaction was, how can I help? What can I do? And there were quite a lot of different coaching projects that were set up, some of them pro bono, some of them not, so that people in our profession weren't feeling quite so powerless. It was that sense of, you know, I'm a helping person here, but I can't do anything. And so when Amanda was looking for folks, I thought, right, yes, if I can help, I will do. So right from the very beginning, it was as though all the rules and the parameters of coaching had changed. We very quickly found that coaching was moving into something else. It was of itself becoming more like counselling or therapy on one end, or the work that was done by, say, bereavement support workers or Samaritans, just listening and listening and listening and listening and holding the space and then listening more. Because people were in tears, people were angry, justifiably angry, exhausted, burnt out. So as coaches, that was the space that we were holding. And yet we weren't always experienced in those areas. I mean, the coaching mindset has tended to be, which direction are we going in? What are our objectives? What are the measurables? What are the outputs? But right here, right now, the outputs was just saying sane. So as a supervisor, my role's been to support coaches to deepen their practice, to be able to work in that field, but at the same time to stay safe and boundaried within the constraints of the profession that we're trained to do, because we're not therapists, even though sometimes are working in that territory. So I've needed to do a lot of deep work myself on being able to fulfil that function. So that question about what can we do to look after ourselves before we can help others has been a really major theme for me. So, I mean, I guess what I've done here, over my time as a coach, I've always worked with a therapist to come to terms with my own back plot, but also to be able to deepen my practice and ground my practice. I've also, during the pandemic, worked more with my supervisor as well. A lot of it just to recognise that, you know, to be honest, good enough is going to have to be good enough. Because this wave is so big and so deep that our measures of what good looks like has had to change. And I'm very capable of beating myself up if I'm not doing it perfectly, which is sort of goes with the turf. One of the things I've also been able to do is spend time with other supervisors who are all going through the same process of supporting coaches to work with clients, not just in the NHS, but in lots of other environments as well, and some of it internationally as well. So just really getting this sense of this pandemic is affecting all of us in many, many different ways. And our motto, if you like, was right now, the world doesn't need tired coaches. And right now, the world didn't need tired supervisors. So what can we do to support each other? And what can we do to build our own ballast and sense of gravity so that we can manage this? On a much more personal level, one of the things I've done has been, I'm a singer, so I enjoyed Zoom singing lessons. I enjoy spending time in my garden, just being as peaceful as I possibly could be, doing yoga, doing Pilates, which all of which helped me to stay in as best as possible something that's called the window of tolerance, which I'll talk to in a minute. But I think the most important thing for me was learning to sit still, learning to do nothing, learning to feel that it was okay to sit still and do nothing, and regroup and look at the trees and just enjoy time to myself, because the world out there needed somebody who wasn't as tired as I would have been if I hadn't done that. So I guess that's again to do with being the difference. And I think with the coaches that I've been working with as a supervisor, that's the thing that has been necessary, been most necessary, that I, because of the work I've done for myself, I've been able to support them to regulate themselves. So if we can move on to looking at the window of tolerance, that would be helpful. This is one of the models that I use when I'm working with coaches around trauma. And you might be familiar with it, you might have come across it. And again, there's an awful lot of stuff that sits behind this. So if you're interested in it, just Google it and you'll find a lot of stuff there. But if you look at the middle line there, we're looking at the optimal arousal zone. And if you can feel into that, think into that, it's a lovely, safe space, the window of tolerance. It's where you feel good about yourself, your feelings are tolerable, you can experience empathy, you're aware of your own boundaries, you're feeling that it's okay to be right here, right now, and everything's fine and safe and comfortable and all right with the world. And in the middle of a pandemic, that is an absolute devil to try and find. So the other two lines here, one is the hyperarousal zone, one is the hypoarousal zone. And if you're moving into the hyperarousal zone, you'll feel yourself getting tighter. You might start getting to feel overwhelmed, maybe difficult or cyclical thoughts. You start feeling angry, start feeling defensive. Your thoughts will be going faster than ideally they normally would. And I'm sure if you're sitting there listening to this, you think, oh yeah, I've been there, happens. Yeah, that I'm no longer in the window of tolerance. I'm in one of those other places that is less comfortable for me to be in. And I think one of the things to be aware of around this is that this is normal. It is not okay. It's what happens when you're in a situation where things are not comfortable for you. The environment isn't supporting you. The other zone, the hypoarousal zone, and again, you may have experienced this if you've had a shock where everything just goes numb. You know, the sensation goes, you lose energy, you feel that you're not there. And if somebody gives you bad news, there's that moment of, oh, I'm not here, this isn't really happening to me. Feel disconnected, no feelings, maybe ashamed, you're a sort of a dead feeling, a passive feeling. And I can't say no. So if you can apply some of those thoughts to where you might have been, where your people might have been over the last couple of years, it's not an unusual space to be. It's normal space to be that some of these things might be happening.
But and I think, Edwina, just coming in there for the benefit of the audience we've got here and the people who... we'll listen to the recording at a later day. You know, the role of the supervisor to be in a optimal space and encourage the coach they're supervising to be in an optimal space, so we can then help our clients to notice where they are. And the NHS has been in a lot of hyper and hypo arousal over the last 2 years, hasn't it? So that's really helpful. I'm wondering, Edwina, about the clients we might be working with now, or the people who might be listening who look at this and go, oh my goodness, I don't think I've ever been in the optimal arousal space for the last 2 years in terms of the work I've been doing and the job I've been doing. What might you say to people if they're noticing that about themselves now?
If you can find a way of getting into a safe space in yourself, then do it. Yeah. So one of the things that works for many people is to, when you can, take some time to yourself and feel into where have you felt most safe in your life. Mm. What does it look like? What does it feel like? What does it smell like? Does it have a taste? Does it have a colour? And when you start feeling yourself moving out of the optimal arousal state, the window of tolerance, then start to feel, how can I get back into that state? Is it something I need to do? Is it something I need, somebody I need to be with? Is it some music I need to listen to? Do I need to go for a walk? Do I need to just take myself off away from other people? Do I need to get in the bath? Whatever it is that works for you. Yeah. To feel that you're in a safe space.
Because people have often found they've got to keep going, haven't they? A lot of our clients have got to keep going. And actually encouraging them and giving them some permission through coaching to to notice what helps and try and put that in their life, however small that is.
Yeah. And it can be very, very small. You don't need to take very long to do this. And
if it around the car park for 10 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah, that
something
one.
Different.
Absolutely. Okay.
Take us on to, we've not got many people on, but you know, one thing we welcome is any questions, put them in the chat as we go, and we'll keep an eye on that, Jack, particularly. But also, you know, when we've worked with individuals, we've used some other tools as well, like the circles of control, which can be really helpful, can't it? So some simple tools that we've used with individuals and teams. So Edwina, I wonder if we, and this is just as simple as building on what Edwina you were saying about finding yourself. So starting with yourself, what's in control for me, and managing our responses and managing our emotions is usually in that space, isn't it? And then where can I influence? And then noticing what's out of my control, noticing what I can't change. And I wonder, Edwina, about what it's been like to help coaches find their sense of control and influence, and what you've noticed about that over the last couple of years.
Often it's to do with saying it's okay. Pretty much like my supervisor has done for me, it is okay not to be perfect. It's okay to just be who you be in the coaching space. Who you are is how you coach. What you're bringing is all right. And simply to be there, to listen, and to be as regulated as you can will actually help the clients to be as regulated as they can. So if I'm self-regulated, the coaches I'm supervising are regulating themselves much more in the window of tolerance, and that will pass directly on to the client, which passes on directly to their team. And best way of describing it is parallel process. So if the relationship between the coach and the supervisor is regulated, the relationship between the coach and the client is regulated, the relationship between the client and their team, the people that they're working with, is more regulated. But to recognise that in the context that we've been working in, this is not the easiest thing in the world, to not beat ourselves up if it's not happening.
So there's something about noticing the impacts any of us can have, you know, the client that we're coaching can have on how they show up on their team, their organisation, and how we show up can model and help them. So, you know, I think there's something about that, but also not beating yourself up when you're not in a great space, because this pandemic has thrown us all off guard continuously, hasn't it? It really has been challenging. Edwina, I wondered the next slide, whether we want to talk a little bit about, you know, what we're finding now, how the coming out has been 2 years in, because lots of our clients have moved to a different space. They've gone back to jobs they were doing before the pandemic. They might have moved into completely new roles. We don't have COVID rushing through the NHS acutely at the rate it has done in the past. And this is an image of a diver coming up, not too quickly, because if you come up too quickly, you get the bends, don't you? And I just wonder, reflections on the here and now, and what it's like in that supervisor space at the moment, Edwina, do you think?
A couple of things that have been coming up. One is that the time that people need to heal, that this has been so traumatic for people. Not just people working in the NHS, but right across the piece. And to expect ourselves just to click straight back in is unrealistic. Yeah. And to expect our people, if we're managing people, to click straight back in is also unrealistic as well. the other side is that people have sort of got used to that extra buzz and that extra speed and the extra sense that it's normal to be outside of the window of tolerance, particularly in the hyperarousal zone. So to start taking more stuff on, because their bodies are used to it, and psychologically they've started to get used to it as well. So I'm finding with some clients, some coaches, to need to sort of just calm down, get back into the window of tolerance. Don't feel that it is normal to be running around and sort of psychologically running around trying to keep that pace going just because we've got used to it over the last couple of years. So I think most of the coming out of it bit is to take time to heal. Take time to recognise that we've all been through this stuff and it isn't going to be the same again.
Three really interesting things in there I'm hearing, Edwina, for the audience. One is it takes time to heal, and we might want to put that next slide up. You know, some people have been traumatised. They maybe experienced PTSD, burnout, moral injury, compassion fatigue. They might have had enough, what they call the great resignation.
Yeah.
There's some great resources available to everyone, not just doctors, on the BMI website about being able to spot that and getting help, you know, and when that's not a coaching space, that's a therapy and a counselling space, but you may notice your colleagues are in that space, because sometimes when you come out of the sort of intensity of it, those things come out. So you said there's lots of trauma around, Edwina, not just in health and social care. I also noticed that there's something about pace, and I made me think of there's a podcast, I can't remember, where they interviewed the CEO of Pfizer, you know, when they had the race for the vaccine. So not only was the NHS rushing towards COVID, but pharma was rushing towards the vaccine, weren't they? And the interviewer asked them, well, can you now, the pace at which you worked in such a short period of time, could you now cure cancer? And he said, this isn't sustainable to work at this level. You'll cure nothing at this rate. This was a once in a lifetime pandemic response. All our scientists, all our lab staff, all the regulators are exhausted. And I noticed what you said about that sort of working at a pace that's too high.
Yeah.
And there's a real pressure in public services, isn't there, that we go, oh, well, we did that, we can do even more.
Yes.
But actually the body needs to recover. The body, you know, we need some time out. So that's worth noticing that. And we've got a comment here from Chris to everybody, your supervisor, reminding you that the body keeps count.
Yeah.
So, you know, what are we noticing in our bodies? And yeah, what do we need? And, you know, it's not being selfish to focus on self-care. We can't care for anybody else, and health and social care are caring professions if we don't care for ourselves. And a lot of people need to get back to that, don't they? That caring for themselves.
Yeah.
But there's some good news. We've seen some good news. We've seen some post-traumatic growth. We've seen people take on new roles. We've seen that whole sort of having to take things to the committee 8 times and still not getting a decision. You know, people were given permission to innovate. And in that space, there have been some exciting developments. People have changed their perspectives and priorities. I definitely noticed that, Edwina, in the men I coach. They now talk much more like the women would have always talked about, I'm not going to be in the office 5 days. I'm not going to do 12 hours of commuting a week. I enjoyed having breakfast with my teenagers. I'm going to keep doing that, or my taking my kids to nursery rather than leaving it to my partner working at home a couple of days. So we've learned what worked and what didn't. You know, we've learned how to treat COVID, haven't we? Things that were done initially, it was all about ventilators. Don't do that now. And I think maybe some organisations have developed a vocabulary around talking about well-being and resilience in a way it's not weakness. It's a sort of humanity and a human factors. Not all boards, Chris, have they? But some have. And I wonder whether there's something in that space about encouraging that being more human, being more real here. Chris, any thoughts from you about what you've noticed? Because you've done a lot of the work talking to the organisations we've now got contracts with while you were in that head of faculty role. What have you noticed?
I think just kind of building on what you were saying, Amanda, about I suppose how people are perceiving wellbeing now, that generally across health and social care, it is getting, I suppose it's more integrated with the whole organisational development piece and the HR function, as opposed to being seen as a bit of a Cinderella thing that's been floating around somewhere. People talking about wellbeing, actually more people now are really understanding, as you were saying, the importance of wellbeing, being part of everything that is about your staff, and everything that's therefore helps things like staff retention, staff recruitment, really, really important parts of successful teams and successful organisations as well. So I think that's been there's a silver lining from the pandemic. I think it's kind of raised the profile of the importance of people feeling that they are safe at work and they want to.
And it has caused a lot of people to think about what their priorities are and the relationship between how they can do effective work, how their team, how their organisation operates, and is this a place that helps me or not? So I think there's maybe something positive about the Great Resignation. People have noticed helpful styles of leadership, unhelpful styles, haven't they? And thinking about priorities there. I don't know whether anyone's got any questions or reflections they wanted to share in the last few minutes with us in the group. Edwina, I'm going to open it to you to maybe share some further thoughts about, what we've learned about people, what we've learned about ourselves through this.
I do come back to that sense that it is okay to be human.
Yeah.
That maybe in the past we were much more sort of boxed in about what, the boundaries between what was right, what was wrong, what was good practice. And I think because folks have much, much, much closer to the whole existential thing about, well, what am I here for? So the idea of people really rethinking their priorities, but also thinking it is actually okay to be vulnerable. It is okay to say, I'm scared by this, this is frightening. It's actually put us back in touch with what it means to be human. Mm-hmm. And I wish it hadn't taken a pandemic to do that.
So yeah, I think we wish it hadn't taken a pandemic to do that. But, that you bring your whole self to work, and of course, teams always did. But maybe we pretended that that wasn't the case, that when we came into the hospital building, we were nurse or doctor or director of this or that, and the person was left at the door. I think what the pandemic has revealed is we bring our whole selves to work, and we bring our whole lives to work. And I suppose the thing I've really enjoyed coaching virtually is people have had their dogs on their laps, their children have come in the room, their babies have joined in the calls, and people have been very apologetic about that. And I've always said, no, if you're happy to keep going with them in the room, let's keep going. And I think there's something about, the humanity and your whole life coming in. It is a shame it took a pandemic to get us to that point, isn't it? But maybe, Chris, there's silver linings there about who I am and why I do this.
Yeah, exactly. I'd really echo what Edwina was saying, that I think people have found themselves again, and they aren't just identifying themselves as a role within an organisation. Actually, it feels a lot more human. And certainly I know that all the conversations that we've been having recently There, you know, there does feel like there's a subtle shift going on in certain teams and organisations in relation to paying more attention to people, humans, as opposed to roles and responsibilities and accountability, which are, you know, again, there's a
silver lining. So there's a real opportunity and a challenge there for boards and owners and leaders in social care to think about your workforce and think about what they need to be effective. Think about how you enable their well-being, how you don't, what, you know, and there's lessons there in the pandemic about the leaders in the organizations who are paying attention to the individuals and their whole lives and what they need, and maybe the organizations who have still got more work to do in that space. Because I think with a limited workforce, we know we don't have enough nurses, doctors, social workers, social care staff, home care staff. They will go to the employer who will give them that as well. And I would say as a coach, when you coach leaders, you know, how are you going to make sure people want to work for you and want to keep working for you? And how are you going to support them and develop them? So maybe that's a good space to think about well-being. And in the last minute, Edwina talked about what she's doing about her well-being. People might have seen on Twitter last night, I had a terrible night's sleep. I'm a certain age and I have a terrible night's sleep every so often. So what helped me was to start a bit slower, to eat a good breakfast, to take a longer dog walk. And, you know, it is important. You know, we run a busy business, we've got lots of contracts, but it is really important to pay attention. Chris, what have you practiced in terms of your well-being in the last week or two?
Well, not a lot, I've been ill, but because of COVID.
About COVID.
But I have taken up tennis recently. So it's something I've always wanted to do, and I played a little bit when I was younger. So I've got a tennis coach. Who's waiting for me to get back on the court.
So it's all things away from the day job, isn't it? That nourish us. And I know other people are running sessions on nourish later today in the seminar. But I think we would say as coaches, notice what's going well, notice what's not going well, and pay attention to what nourishes you. Is a good place to finish. I think we're at time almost now. So thank you, everybody, for giving us some time and attention. I know some people joined us through the session. And I know, Michaela, others will get to watch at a later date. So thanks for inviting us. And I guess what I'd say on the final thing is, you know where to find us. www.ltdblend.com. Reach out to any of us there. But also think about doing one of the IHSM courses that we've developed in Blend around mentoring your colleagues, because there's a real opportunity to learn some mentoring skills yourselves there as IHSM members. So there's an introduction to mentoring, there's a performance mentoring course, and very soon there's going to be a mentoring for wellbeing course there as well. So make use of all those marvellous IHM resources as well.